available. So like I told you, you know, you are frequently, to give you a very crude example, if you are frequently looking at websites, say Gmail or rediff.com, every day you are looking at those websites, those website addresses will be there in the cache memory. And when you get a success, it is a cache hit, and when you get a failure, it is a cache miss. This is what I told you in the last class. I also told you that, you know, it is always better to have candidate type architectures where there are different types of architectures are better. So we can use them, you know, candidate type architecture means this P0, which is the processor with the memory and the network card. This P0 can be a different architecture. P1 can be a different architecture. P2 can be different architecture. That gives a more advantages in parallel systems. When you have heterogeneous systems, there is a huge advantage with those kind of architectures. The diversity increases. But if you are going for a single pointed agenda, you know, you don't have multiple applications, then maybe homogeneous or same type of processors may also be okay. I mean, you are not having diverse application. You are only specifically having a problem. Maybe you can go for a homogeneous solution where all the parallel systems have the same configuration, same hardware, and so on. So today we are going to see two basic concepts of data and task parallelism. Now, when I say data parallelism, what it means is that different sets of data are taken. The data set is huge, and the same the data set is divided into different blocks. One block is given to one processor, and the same operation is done by that processor. So much of data is there. The data set is huge. That data set is divided into packets or packages. Each package is given to one processor, and all the processors do the same operation. This is data parallelism. But primarily, when we use parallel systems, high performance systems, we most of the time don't use it for too much of data parallelism. We do use, but mostly we use it for task parallelism. Right? Task parallelism also we use. Here, each processor does a different task. And each processor does different tasks, and there is a load balancing between the things. And that is another way of parallelism. And generally, some cases we mix both also, right? But when we have high-end computational requirements, like, you know, weather forecasting, right? Weather forecasting, the algorithm may be simple, but you are grappled with so much of data. You need to number crunch lot of data. Then probably we go for data parallelism. So the data is divided into packages. Each package is given to a processor, and each processor does the same operation on all the data. Whereas task parallelism, each computer does a different task. And there is some load balancing, some coordination, some communication, and all those kind of things. We can even combine both. Now, for the there is something called a parallel formulation and a parallel algorithm. Parallel formulation means you have a normal serial algorithm. You have Towers of Hanoi, or you have some algorithm. You have a Dijkstra's SPF, a shortest path first. Now, this algorithm is serial in nature, but when you want to parallelize it and give it to multiple processors the same algorithm, you do a parallelization or a parallel formulation. You decompose or partition the pieces of work of the algorithm, the serial algorithm, and you assign different tasks to different processors. This is what happens in parallel formulation. So you have an algorithm. The algorithm is serial in nature, but you want to parallelize it and formulate it parallelly. You break that algorithm into, decompose it into different partitions or different threads. We can say threads, and have each thread given to a processor. Now, parallel algorithm is totally different. Here, the algorithm itself is parallel in nature, in the sense that the algorithm itself parallelizes, and each thread is given directly to a processor or a core. Now, I don't need to tell you that parallel formulation is much more difficult. Parallel algorithm means upfront you are writing the algorithm in such a way that it is parallelized or it is in threads, and you are giving each thread to a processor. It is much simpler. But parallel formulation is difficult because you need to decompose, you need to partition either the task you need to partition, or you probably need to partition the data, either do task parallelism or data parallelism. But it is not easy. You will have to do that. It will take a lot of time. It will take a lot of overhead. And as a result, the performance, I already told you about the lambda, the latency value. We always want to reduce the latency or the lambda value. And the logic does not work at all. You have P processors and T time. When you have P processor, time does not divide it by T by M, P. It doesn't happen. You have 10 minutes and you have 5 processors. The time will not be 2 minutes. 10 divided by 5 does not, never ever it happens. No problem is like that where it happens. There is overhead, there is interaction, there is shared variables, there is data inputs. There is process between the processes, there is coordination, communication, agreement, sharing of global variables, and so on. Some problems we have seen, like a Monte Carlo simulation, there is very good result when you have more parallel, but generally lot of overhead is there. There will be performance loss. In sequential computation, there is no overhead, but here, parallelizing, you will definitely have some overhead. You will have idle processors sometimes. Sometimes the load will not be there. Sometimes processors will be fighting for the shared resources. Contention will be there for resources. And all this will result in what is known as a parallel overhead. Because there will be extra computation, 5 processors are doing the same job. They have to talk to each other. They have to share processing. They have to share computation. There are global variables that need to be accessed by all the 5 processors. There are shared variables which processors may need to use. There are communication between the processors, and so on and so forth. So these kind of things will definitely result in overhead. One trick is definitely to convert the processes into threads. We will see that threads are very, very advantageous. Threads have one address space. Threads are very lightweight. Threads are faster to set up. Threads are faster to kill. Threads are dynamic, whereas processes are little more heavyweight, take a lot of memory. You need to swap address spaces. They're not so easy to kill. You might, if you recall in operating systems, I taught you that a program will have multiple processes. In process, what is a process? A process is nothing but a program in execution. A program will have many processes, and the best way is to break down that process into threads, which we saw in multi-threading. And these threads are very easy to, you know, create, to destroy, very lightweight, very little address space, very less overhead is there. So to reduce the parallel overhead that comes because of the communication, the collaboration, the sharing of global variable, the storage sharing, the computation, it is better to go for threads. We will see that in the next class, because we need to always ensure that the latency is less. Latency refers to the amount of time it takes to complete a given unit of work. And because of multiple processes, even though there is a speed up, the speed up may not be as much as you expect it to be. whereas you want to reduce the latency and increase the throughput. Throughput is the maximum amount of work that you can complete in a unit time. So the logic is to maximum increase the amount of work and reduce the latency, the delay. You know, some delay is inevitable because, you know, processors have to talk to each other, have to collaborate with each other, have to share variables. But still, our logic is to maximize the throughput. One way of maximizing the throughput is pipeline. So there is one instruction going like this, second instruction, third instruction, fourth instruction, fifth instruction, sixth instruction. You break it down to five threads. First instruction, second instruction, five threads. So when the first instruction's first thread is going, nothing is happening. When the second instruction's, so this is going to one processor, this is going to another processor, this is going to another processor, this is going like that, you can have. So when the first instruction's first thread is going, others are idle. When the second first instruction's second thread is going to the first processor, the first thread of the second process can go to the second processor and vice versa. This is a very good way to pipeline and increase the throughput. And we will see the I already told you multi-threading is very advantageous. See how multi-threading is happening. It will increase the reduce the latency, it will increase the reduce the lambda and do things in parallel. But then there could be other issues like contention, where, you know, processors are waiting for things. The action of one processor may interfere with another processor. It could be both of them are trying to take this common bus. Both of them are trying to take the same input-output device. So those issues will also result in loss. There will be load imbalance when you are doing task parallelism. One processor may be doing a lot of work. Another processor may be doing very little work. I told you the example of an Onam Sadhya, right? The person who is making the avial will have it the toughest. Most difficult job to make is the avial. But the guy who is making the payasam, it's a cakewalk for him. It's very simple, right? So that kind of load imbalances will be also there, and that will also result in performance loss. Contention or waiting for resources will also, interfering in each other will also do, and so on. I'll close for today. Tomorrow I will start with the threading concept. So couple of announcements before. So what I covered till today and tomorrow, you will have actually what I covered till today, tomorrow is not included, I think, will be there in a last quiz we will have on Monday. After this, there will be no more quizzes for you. So we will, tomorrow I will take a class. What I teach tomorrow is not included, if I'm not mistaken, in the quiz. That will be taken for the midterm and end term. So we will wind up all the internal assessment with respect to the quizzes on Monday. That will be the last part, the part of parallel computing, parallel systems, which I covered post the other quiz. So I think it's okay. We'll finish everything. Now you are safe. So I have a slightly different plan for the midterm and the end term. I will discuss with you in the earlier, but I don't want to have a MCQ or a fill in the blanks exam. I want you to do something solid, and I will tell you those questions ahead of schedule so that you can start working on it, at least for the midterm, and the end term we will see later. So generally speaking, I thought some algorithms that we have learned in distributed systems, we can probably have some sort of programming test on that midterm. You do a submission, and based on that, I will evaluate. But I will tell you those questions ahead of schedule. Anyway, we have more than 1 month. By 10th of September, your syllabus will be 10th to 12th, 15th of September. Your syllabus will be completely over, and then I will leave you with free classes so that you have time. At least you have 15 days to prepare for the midterm and more than a month and a half to prepare for the end term, end semester. But both VIVAs will have questions from everywhere. Viva cannot be, Viva will have midterm Viva. I will tell you the syllabus. It will be primarily I am thinking of having only a small part of parallel systems for the Viva and mostly distributed systems for the Viva of the midterm. End term I will be discuss as we move forward. So that is all for today. I'll close for the class. Please answer your attendance. You see, one person is absent. Otherwise, I could have given you full. Anyway, can't help it. Abhilash, Akash, Amit.